Onward, IFX Expo LATAM 2024. I'm joined now by Andrew Lane, CEO and founder of Acuity. Andrew, welcome. It's great to see you again in a different part.
Muchas gracias. Thank you for having me.
So Acuity recently launched the research terminal. I wanted to ask you, can you provide some insights into its adoption and, let's say, the success of the rollout?
Yeah, so it's been a culmination of our product department building out various parts, and we've gradually staggered it. And the last part was launched, I would say at the end of last year, and then we've had an add-on through an email technology that we developed, which is buzzing. And I would say the beginning of this year, down to amazing product and amazing sales team, we've had an amazing rollout of the product with new clients, but also our old clients adopting it as we integrate into more platforms. And the technology of breaking content out of the research terminal using multiple methods such as WhatsApp or Telegram and such forth, it's really singing well.
So Acuity training is powered by AI before AI even became mainstream with generative AI. Besides sort of the infamous AI washing, do you see competent AI powered solutions coming into the market? I guess my question is, how do we address increased competition in space? I apologize, I interrupted you there in the beginning. You want to
AI, I think, is quite a lazy term. In the sense what you're saying, like AI washing, like people use it and they say we're AI powered, we're AI this, we're AI that. And I don't think there's much understanding. And I was talking over dinner last night with a friend who's in this field. And in some ways, I feel quite low key on this. Like, I'm involved heavily in this, and I have been involved in the science of natural language processing, which underpins the likes of OpenAI and the new large language models. But the depth to which it goes is immense, and the technology and what we're capable of doing is amazing. And I come also from the background of media, as you know, from the Wall Street Journal, the Dow Jones, and there was this big threat at the beginning of the century where the internet broke open the ability for people to provide news, such as yourself, your website and such forth. And now large language models and AI are breaking open the ability to create news on itself. So it's a really interesting time, and it provides as a threat to traditional businesses, but it also provides as an opportunity to many businesses. And my feeling is that if you understand what underpins this and what you can do with this, then it is a big opportunity. But I also think a lot of companies are going to get eaten up by this technology.
I wanted to ask you, what are the sort of industry trends that you've witnessed at this event so far, stage two now, and maybe more broadly in Latin America?
Yeah, so what I hear a lot is the countries being mainly Mexico, Colombia and Brazil, but there's also a lot of mix up and misunderstanding around how they can access these markets and the regulation and such forth. It's not my area of expertise, but there's a lot of confusion, but there's a lot of desire to get into these markets. And the event itself is, I would say, a lot more busy than I expect today anyhow. Yesterday was a little bit quieter, but today it's definitely booming. I don't know if you feel the same. And it's really interesting. And overall, I think the market, I see, like the industry we're in, has moved. There are two things I've noticed. First of all, we were talking about US and Europe. Then we moved to Africa and Asia. And now LATAM is the big area of growth. And the other thing that we see a lot of people talking about is prop trading. And it's really interesting to me. My nephew, literally, I'm waking up to messages him saying, look, I'm thinking of doing prop trading, XYZ, and the numbers that people are talking about are just incredible in terms of the volume. I mean, it's surpassing brokerage. It's incredible. And it's a really interesting take on trading. I've also been talking to a lot of prop trading firms, the owners, and around the technology and around the regulation and how that works out. And we've seen what's happened with MetaTraders, and I'm interested to see how it goes, because and also in LATAM, see what happens.
Well, the prop trading topic seems to be taking over a lot of conversations. And speaking to several, let's say, prop trading technology leaders in our space. Yesterday, you know, we spoke about the fact that this is reminiscent of retail effects 15, 20 years ago.
Yeah.
In terms of, you know, a few bad actors ruining it for the rest, but then weeding out bad actors in the process, and then coming to a level playing field for all. For brokerages, for retail brokerages that are established that are now launching their own prop offering, and then native standalone prop firms.
We've seen lots of bubbles over the years. You and I have been in the industry. You've seen binary options, you've seen cryptos, you've seen FX, you know, spread betting in the UK, turbos in Germany and such forth. Yeah, this is interesting. I can't quite work out, and there will be bad actors, of course. But one thing I do feel is that, and I heard, is that people want to trade. They want the feeling of being able to trade intraday and such forth. And the more regulators clamp down on it, the more people innovate and find different ways of giving what people want. And so there's this balance. And I think, you know, what I hear from brokers is in Europe, it's been over-regulated, especially in the UK. And it just pushes people into different hands and different innovations. So I don't know whether regulation is healthy in this instance.
Andrew, I guess to finish up, I wanted to ask you, feel free to not respond. I think that you recall recently there was a situation with our friends at FX Street, a different publication involved, let's say, artificial intelligence, writing content, if you recall. I wanted to see if you had an opinion on what happened. I think I tried to reach out to some folks in the industry.
Yeah, I think it's between them, it's a very personal thing. You know, these two companies, FX Street and the other one, have been around for many, many years, and they've been very competitive with each other. So, and as to what they're doing, well, you know, this is a wider degree of things that's happening. Like, we see the New York Times suing OpenAI. We see other publications working with AI, OpenAI in bigger ways. I think this very much leads into what we were talking about before, how the industry is going to be disrupted by the ability for, frankly, for people to create their own news feeds using large language models. And I think that poses a massive threat to news organizations. So this argument is just a part of that overall issue.
Yeah, I think we touched upon that in the podcast that we did together last June.
Yeah.
You gave us that fair warning even back then.
Yeah, I mean, I was speaking to a great friend who's the CEO of a very, very large brokerage, and they've already created their own newsfeed. And I think that also talks to the theme that companies just don't value news in the way they did 20 years ago. And this throws out a question to large news organizations, small news organizations, is what are you going to do about it? And then it throws out a question to the likes of OpenAI. If you kill off the news industry, which the internet nearly did, then what are you going to base your large language models off in the future? And that hasn't balanced out yet, that argument.
Great. Well, thanks for sharing your insights on all of these important questions. And it's great to see you again. Good luck the rest of the way. We'll probably see you in June in Cyprus.
Absolutely.